And we pick up on some of the legal questions being asked about the criminal case against Dzhokhar Tsarnaev. If Tsarnaev is found guilty as charged of using a weapon of mass destruction, he could face the death penalty. But what else does he and should he face? For that, we turn to David Rivkin, who served in the Justice Department in the Reagan and Bush administrations, and Laura Murphy, director of the Washington Legislative Office for the American Civil Liberties Union. David Rivkin, start by explaining to us what this means, using a weapon of mass destruction. Is it a term of legal art?
It is a term of art, Gwen, and good to be with you. It is obviously a manifestation of the seriousness of the attack. It is a charge that carries a death penalty. And I, for one, given the wealth of physical evidence and other evidence that the prosecution would be able to bring to bear, would be quite comfortable predicting that he would be convicted and sentenced appropriately.
Laura Murphy, that term, weapon of mass destruction, is that a relatively new kind of charge?
Yeah, that's in statute. Congress created that term, and it's a very broad term, and it's been broadly interpreted.
Is part of the broad interpretation what the penalty would be?
I don't understand your question.
Is, as David Rifkin just said, part of the reason why that kind of charge is brought is because it is makes you liable for the death penalty?
Well, we don't know whether the federal prosecutors are going to charge this suspect with the death penalty. So it is a prosecution that can result in a death sentence.
Let me ask you and then David Rifkin this question. Were there other options besides this particular charge for charging this young man?
Oh, there are many options. But we don't know that the charges that are brought have been completed. This individual could be prosecuted in state court. This individual could face further federal charges. So this by no means means the end of the charging process.
David Rifkin, what else would you imagine that he could be charged with based on what we know?
Well, if I may, Gwen, it's not just a question of what he will be charged with. There are other charges. I agree with my colleague about the possibility of state prosecutions. I think what's important, this administration has made a serious mistake in not considering, completely taking off the table, the possibility of classifying him as a potential enemy combatant and subjecting him to the interrogation process that would have frankly yielded a lot more in terms of intelligence than the standard criminal justice type interrogation process. And it has nothing to do with Miranda, on which everybody has been focusing. It is simply the case that an interrogation process that would last for a period of weeks and maybe months and enables the interrogation team to develop without any interruptions a full intelligence take is not something you can do in a criminal justice system, because once he's charged, he's entitled to a lawyer. And his lawyer, even if he does not tell him not to cooperate, you just wouldn't be able to structure the interrogation in the same process. That's a loss. That's very unfortunate.
Laura Murphy, in fact, he has now been assigned a lawyer, and this enemy combatant option was pretty vigorously taken off the table today by Jay Carney at the White House. What did you think about that?
We thought it was an excellent idea to prosecute this individual in the criminal justice system, in our federal courts, because the enemy combatant status does not allow for due process, does not allow for right to counsel, does not have the same presumption of innocence. And we hold our system out to the world as being the model for justice. That is a very different, secretive process. And in fact, John Brennan, who's now the director of the CIA, when he was national security advisor, argued against holding people as enemy combatants and in military detention for the purposes of interrogation, because he cited at least three major terrorism cases where the individuals were tried under our federal criminal court system, and they cooperated even after having counsel. And this system, this criminal justice system of our federal government, has prosecuted over 400 terrorism-related cases. You have the blind sheikh in custody, you have Massawi in custody, you have Terry Nichols, who was part of the Oklahoma City bombing. You have Eric Rudolph, who was part of the Atlanta terrorism bombings related to the Olympics. So there's no problem in our criminal justice system prosecuting alleged acts of terrorism.
What about that, David?
Let me just jump in. This is a straw man. Nobody is suggesting that Dzhokhar cannot be prosecuted in the criminal justice system. But prosecuting him is just part of the equation. The real question for us is this. This is not just an act of terror. This is an act of war, at least potentially an act of war, on the theory that his brother was inducted in an al-Qaeda-affiliated entity, and then he came back to, during his stay in the Caucasus, he came back to the United States, he inducted his brother.
And so far we know that all to be a theory, right? Not part of the charge.
But the whole point of enemy combatants is that you hold people and you build information in part based upon interrogation results. By the way, apropos of a point made by my colleagues, there's nothing wrong with the military justice system, and if it feels otherwise, you should take issue with the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court, in a number of key decisions, both prior to 9/11 but also after 9/11 in a case called Hamdi, very much affirmed the continuing viability and constitutionality of the laws of war paradigm. So let me just say briefly, I'm not suggesting he would have been prosecuted in the military commission. The existing law does not allow for it. It's specifically off the table. But he could have been interrogated and held for a number of months as an enemy combatant. And then, just like happened with Padilla, just like happened with Hamdi, Mr. Hamdi could have been transferred to the criminal justice system to be prosecuted.
But since we now know that's not what is going to happen and that the administration has made very clear what their approach will be, I'd like to focus a little bit on what the challenge is that's now ahead for the prosecutors and for the defense in a case like this, Laura Murphy.
Well, first of all, they have to get their facts together. We just don't know what the facts are in this case. And we cannot say that this individual agreed with his older brother's ideological beliefs. We don't know that. And so this person has counsel. Counsel is going to meet with this person to make sure that the charges are fair and build a case based on the facts. We can't predict how this case is going to go. We know that the federal government has to conform with rules of evidence, and we think that they are going about this prosecution in the manner that really comports with our American values and our constitutional rights.
David Rivkin.
I'm surprised, actually, to hear you say that, because, quite frankly, in an effort to avoid dealing with the option that I mentioned, by not Mirandizing him, they have actually created some problems for themselves. And in this
he
regard,
was Mirandized. He was Miranda. Well,
actually, as of today, when he was charged, she was.
Yes.
But there was a delay. You're right.
There was a delay, and I agree with Professor Dershowitz, who points out the danger of this kind of a blending of the two paradigms. Because he was not Mirandized initially, it may be difficult for the prosecution lots of physical evidence, as I said, but as far as his state of mind, as far as what made him do this, and I agree with Laura, there might be some difficulties, which, again, underscores the proposition that you pay a price when you take some options off the table. You make other options more difficult for you.
Even though he wasn't Mirandized right away and apparently was in communication with the investigators, are you okay with that?
No, we're not okay because we don't know the facts. We don't know what he was compelled to answer. We don't know whether he knew what was going on, whether he was of sound enough mind. We think the public safety exception should be very, very limited. We don't know whether they abused the public safety exception. So we're not prepared to say everything's okay just because he's been Mirandized. But we are relieved that he's being tried in federal court and that he was Mirandized.
Laura Murphy of the American Civil Liberties Union and David Rifkin, Baker Hostetler. Thank you both so much.
Thank you.